Call this meeting of the Board of Supervisors of August 19, 2013 to order. Roll call, please.
Supervisor Bronson.
Present.
Supervisor Carroll. Supervisor Elias.
Presente.
Supervisor Miller.
Here.
Chairman Valdez.
Present.
Let the record show that Supervisor Carroll is not present. All other members are.
Today's invocation will be offered by Pastor Richard Santiago of Emmanuel Christian Church and will be followed by a Pledge of Allegiance by Supervisor Elias. Everyone, please stand.
Thank you. Let us pray. Dear wise and loving Father, first let me say thank you on behalf of all who are gathered here today. Thank you for your many and abundant blessings. Thank you for the life itself and for the measure of health we need to fulfill our callings, for sustenance and for friendship. Thank you for the ability to be involved in useful work and for the honor of bearing appropriate responsibilities. Thanks as well for the freedom to embrace you or for the freedom to reject you. Thank you for the loving us even so from your boundless and gracious natures. In the scriptures, you have said that the citizens ought to obey the governing authorities, since you have established those very authorities to promote peace and order and justice. Therefore, I pray for the Board of Supervisors, for the various levels of county officials, in particular, for this assembled council. I'm asking you that you would graciously grant them wisdom to govern, amend the conflicting interests and issues of our times, a sense of welfare and true needs of our people, a keen thirst of justice and rightness, confidence in what is good and fitting, and the ability to work together in harmony even when there is an honest disagreement. Personal peace to their lives and joy in their tasks. I pray for this agenda set before them today. Please give an assurance of what would please you and what would benefit those who live and work in and around our beloved city of Tucson and the Pima County. It is in your most blessed name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor.
Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Elias.
I'd ask for a moment of personal privilege.
Please proceed.
Just wanted to remind everybody that it's now Tucson's birthday week, and tomorrow night over at the Presidio over here on Church in Washington, they'll be having the annual flag-raising ceremony. It's a lot of fun. They have some nice little treats for kids and birthday cake and all that kind of stuff. Then they fire out that big old cannon and you know, shocks everybody, because I tell you, that thing is loud. And we try and talk them into not aiming it at any county buildings, but, you know, it kind of changes from year to year as to what they do with it. But it's always a lot of fun and gives us a chance to honor the people who have helped build this community and the 4,000 years of humanity present here in the Santa Cruz River Valley. So thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, for allowing me that moment.
Thank you. Next, we'll go on to Pause for Pause. And today with Officer Bowden, we have Zach, who is a Sonoran purebred with a duck.
And a nice coat of hair, I might add, too. Very pretty, huh?
Good morning. This is Zach, and actually, the funny thing about the duck, actually, is one of the gals down in our licensing center has a collection of dog toys, and they were just kind of pinned up to the side of her desk, and Zach helped himself to one of them. And when that employee tried to wrestle it back from him, we decided that, you know, this Zach didn't have any toys, and she had so many, so she went ahead and let it go. And he's been carrying it around most of the morning since then. He's pretty cute with it. Zach is not my normal pick for this, aside from the fact that he's a big brown dog, and I typically bring big brown dogs. But as many of you know, I usually bring in the dog that's been there the longest. Zach's only been with us for 3 weeks. He hasn't even been there a month, which sadly a lot of dogs do stay more than a month. What kind of called my attention to Zach, besides his nice demeanor, and the reason I brought him today was Zach was an owned dog. He wasn't just a stray dog picked up out of the street. He had an owner that kicked and hit him. And in my line of work, I've seen far more extreme situations. His was unfortunately on the milder side. But fortunately for him, his owner decided to just sign him over, no fuss, just agreed to let go of ownership and let him move on to a new home. But because he came to us with such unfortunate circumstances, I thought, well, he kind of needs an extra boost to get out of there, because he had worse circumstances than many that are just strays coming in, that he was mistreated. He doesn't seem to have any consequences for it. He's well-rounded and very well-mannered. Obviously, somebody spent some time training him. He will sit and he will walk on a leash very nicely. No signs of any kind of aggression towards anybody. So it's really difficult to say, you know, who might have treated him wrong. Oftentimes, dogs will pick up on certain physical characteristics in a person and have aggression towards that type of person. He's fine with men, women, big, small, anybody, ever, uniform, ununiformed. This dog is just happy to be given some attention. Did quite like going to the lake this morning. Took him down to see the ducks. He didn't seem overly adventurous about chasing after the ducks, but he did seem very, very interested in getting in the water. So if you're looking for a water companion, this is probably the dog. And I know that matters. I have a dog that refuses to swim with me. I wish she would, but some people seek out dogs that swim. So this one's a swimmer. If you're interested in a swimming dog, he's the one. He's going at our discounted rate, which is the $50 rate right now. That's $35 adoption fee and a $15 licensing fee. He's already been neutered. He has his microchip in already. He's pretty much ready to go home, just looking for a good new home. If you work in public education, though, you can have this dog for free through the month of August, which is almost up. So quickly, all the teachers, principals, employees of public schools, please get down to our facility and get your dog while you can. Plenty of others to choose from. Also, one more thing I wanted to mention while I'm here is this Saturday we're having a open house for our volunteers from 3 to 4. It takes about 45 minutes. You don't need to register in advance. Just come on down, and they'll walk you through what it takes to be a volunteer, what sort of opportunities there are, and you can get in with some really neat people doing that. So this Saturday from 3 to 4, please come on down. A few minutes of your time, 45 minutes, not much, and sign up for some volunteer opportunities. So thank you, as always, for your time. And this is Zach. If you know anybody looking for a swimming dog, we've got him. He'll be waiting, ready to go home today at noon. So we're open noon to 7 weekdays, 10 to 5 on weekends, located at 4000 North Silverbell. Thank you very much.
Mr. Chairman. I was going to suggest that we should adopt this dog on behalf of Raymond and give it to him since he's absent from today's meeting. Just seemed to make sense to me, you know, but in lieu of that, because I don't want to be considered as just making trouble for the sake of making trouble, I would say that Melinda Cervantes and Pat Correa are here, so you know, any of those librarians who might be interested in taking a dog home, please talk to them about it. I won't brace the two of you up specifically to take this dog home, but wouldn't it be nice for one of the librarians to be able to take this dog home with them at some point in time, and frankly, for anybody who wants to adopt this dog, District 5 would be willing to pick up the fees on this dog, because seems to be a nice animal, and like I said, pretty hair and a great smile, and you know, walking around with a stuffed duck in your mouth is not a bad thing, I guess, you know, on a nice August day. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, and I understand he's very literate too, so you know, he could help read to kids.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. At this point, we'll go ahead and move to the presentation on the addendum agenda item number one, Child Support Awareness Month.
I'll move that.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. I'll ask Supervisor Miller to make the presentation. Is Rosa Torres here? Is anyone here from the Child Support Services? Well, Supervisor, if you could just read it from the dais, then.
Okay. I'll just read the proclamation in support of Child Support Awareness Month. The proclamation, whereas communities should be engaged to help families benefit from co-parenting, and whereas providing financial support is part of parental responsibility, affording a greater opportunity for the involvement of both parents and increasing the opportunity for children to reach their full potential. And whereas the Arizona Department of Economic Security Division of Child Support Enforcement, which will now be known as the Division of Child Support Services, collaborates with the Office of the Attorney General, federal and state agencies, tribal governments, county attorney offices, county clerks of the court, faith-based and community organizations, fatherhood groups, enforcement agencies, the business community and employers, and other interested parties in sustaining a community that assists parents in establishing a financial partnership to support their children. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Pima County Board of Supervisors hereby proclaims the month of August 2013 to be Child Support Awareness Month, passed and adopted this day, 19th day of August 2013.
Thank you. Thank you, Supervisor Miller. I do have changes to the agenda. On the regular agenda, page 3, item number 13, Natural Resources, Parks and Recreation, Chuck Catino Softball Complex, resolution number 2013-73. Staff requests this item be removed from the agenda. On page 4, item 24, Development Services, the applicant requests this item be continued to the Board of Supervisors meeting of October 15, 2013. On the addendum agenda, page 1, item 4, executive session, First American Title Trust 9291 versus Pima County Arizona Tax Court. Staff requests this item be removed from the agenda. Without objection, those will be the changes to the agenda. And I'm going to go ahead and move to a couple of items.
Pardon?
Those are just the changes to the agenda. I understand you're for item 24.
Yes.
It'll be continued to the meeting of October 15th. I'm going to go ahead and I don't.
For your information, that was at the request of the applicant. We always honor an applicant's request.
Okay, unfortunately, the neighbors weren't notified. We just got that this morning.
We just got it this morning, so.
All right, we'll go ahead. I will move to regular agenda item number 11, Humane Borders.
Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Miller.
Regarding the Humane Borders supplying the water in the desert at a cost of $22,000 for the taxpayers, it's identified as reducing the need, and therefore the suggestion is a cost of aggressive search and rescue operations in the desert. In addition to the water, Humane Borders will purchase, deliver, and laminate maps and information brochures to be placed at border stations printed in English and Spanish. I'd just like to note that in a report from CNN on Friday, August 16, 2013, federal agents did a nationwide sweep targeting the violent MS-13 street gang, and more than 263 people were arrested. Among those were 158 members of the MS-13 street gang. Special agents also seized 28 firearms, 10 kilos of marijuana, 123 grams of cocaine, and over 770 grams of heroin, and a large amount of cash. MS-13 is identified as one of the most dangerous transnational criminal gangs in the world. They operate chapters in 42 states across the country, according to the FBI. Among their criminal activities, drug trafficking across the border, murder, rape, and robbery. Last October, President Barack Obama's administration named the organization a transnational criminal enterprise with the goal of realizing millions of dollars in profits from drug and sex trafficking operations. Talk to the family of Brian Terry, who was murdered by those crossing our border illegally, and those responsible still have not been brought to justice. Agents on the border lay their lives down every day to protect us from gangs, human traffickers coming across our border. Yet we place water stations, informational brochures in the desert to aid these traffickers, among others, to help with their safe and swift passage on the highway to the United States. With the porous border, thousands of illegal aliens are brought in, many of whom end up in sex and/or labor enslavement scenarios, coerced into working in various service industries at lower pay than what we pay here in the country. By providing these water stations and MAP, we are aiding and abetting the lawbreakers, human traffickers, drug cartels, the MS-13 gangs entering this country illegally, whether it's inadvertent, I'm sure, but that's happening. Those who enter our country illegally come here for numerous reasons, but the route they are taking to get here, many by paying a human drug trafficker to help them cross. Human and drug traffickers to help them cross. These poor people are abused. They are forced to carry drugs, raped, beaten, and often left for dead. Do you really believe the coyote, human drug trafficker, drug dealer is going to go back to find the poor soul who is dying of thirst a few hundred yards back once they reach the water stations? I have heard numerous arguments against the gas pipeline stating that this will provide a highway for the illegal entrance into the United States. Yet these same people think it is a good thing to put these water stations in the desert, along with maps and other information. No one wants to see one human being die in the desert. Yet you are justifying this by the cost savings for aggressive search and rescue operations. You don't consider the cost to our society with these gangs operating in our streets in 42 states, murdering our citizens, dealing in drugs, and the horrific cost of human trafficking, especially among children. This cost far outweighs the costs of search and rescue operations in the desert. One thing that has always come to my attention is, why haven't we explored using something like the solar-powered stations that we have along the highways as an emergency beacon for those in distress to contact our border patrol? Then we know who is coming into the country. Then we know what they are doing here. And most importantly, we need more security on our border. I just heard Sheriff Paul Babu testify to this firsthand. Enforcement works. Enforcement would stop the flow of the drug traffickers and human traffickers through the desert, and our monies are more wisely spent there. With that said, I make a motion to deny funding Humane Borders for this water in the desert.
Is there a second? Hearing none, motion dies for lack of a second.
Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Elias.
I can appreciate Supervisor Miller's sentiments, but there's no evidence that any of those murderous gangs have taken advantage of Humane Borders placing this water out there in the desert. And we do need to find a resolution to the immigration issues that are plaguing this nation and the migration phenomena that has affected us, especially here in Arizona. There is some relevance to an argument to be made about the cost effectiveness of search and rescue, but there's also, for me, and I admit this is only Richard's opinion, that as people of faith, we have a moral obligation to try and save people's lives who make that dangerous trek into the desert. And we have to act in a humanitarian way rather than blindly attacking these people who want so much to improve their lives and have an opportunity to live here in America. And our immigration system is so broken that they are unable to come here legally. It's an unfortunate situation. But in order to reduce the number of people who die out there in the desert, I thank Humane Borders for what they've been able to do throughout their history. And I'm proud to support them. And I think they're a key part of our community. And they speak loudly about the sensibilities of people here in Tucson and Pima County and the fact that we understand that we live in the borderlands and that there is a humanitarian aspect to all of that that we should respect as people of faith. With that, I'm going to move item 11, Humane Borders. And contract amount, $22,500.
Mr. Chairman?
Second.
Okay, there's motion and second. Supervisor Miller.
I'd just like to respond to that I am a person of faith, and I'd like to point out that there is no evidence that these people are not using these water stations. So no one can prove that they're not using them, and I assume that they probably are. But at the end of the day, we have to think about the cost to the lives that are here in this country and the poor people crossing who are abused, as I said. Those people are relying upon this criminal enterprise to help them get across the country, and that was my point. No one wants to see anyone die in the desert. But I think there's a better solution, and I agree with Richard that we need to work on this and we need to come to a solution. Thank you.
As I said, I understand Supervisor Miller's sentiment, and I don't think that her comments are coming from an angry, negative, bad place, but I wanted to make sure folks understand that there's a very different perspective on this issue on this Board of Supervisors as well.
Mr. Chairman. I seconded the motion, so obviously I'm going to support it. And I appreciate the comments made by Supervisor Miller. I think she might find it instructive to, at some point, maybe take a tour with Humane Borders to see what they actually do. I was impressed with what they did, and therefore I am comfortable supporting this item.
All right, I do have two speakers. I'm going to go ahead and call them up. I'm going to ask each of you to keep your comments to 3 minutes. There's a timer here. When it flashes red, your 3 minutes are up. It'll flash yellow at a minute left. So let me call Dinah Bear. Please come up, identify yourself for the record, and you have 3 minutes.
Good morning, Chairman Valadez, honorable supervisors, and Mr. Huckleberry, also honorable. My name is Dinah Bear. I chair Humane Borders, a faith-based charitable organization dedicated to saving lives in the borderlands. We are grateful for the opportunity to come before you this morning and renew our request for county assistance to maintain a system of water stations in southern Arizona. It has been a tough and hot summer, not over yet. All of our water stations are on public lands, are under government permit, and of course the stations on private lands are there with private landowner permission, but that hasn't stopped some people who are concerned about our mission and object to it from vandalizing both our trucks and our water stations. Our trucks themselves are aging, and in the repair shop a great deal, we're bringing a truck back from Ajo this morning. At the same time, the Border Patrol has been consulting with us throughout the summer about effective messaging in Central and South Mexico and Central America to deter people from coming in the first place. We do have maps showing how many days it is from particular points into Tucson and Phoenix and other places in Arizona. The Border Patrol does also. That is actually an attempt to persuade people to give them the truth about how long it takes to walk from the border to these locations. We know for a fact that migrants are told that it's 45 minutes to Tucson or Phoenix, or even in one case, 45 minutes to New York City from the border. The people that founded our organization thought this situation would only last a year or two. Very regrettably, they were wrong. Even though the number of apprehensions has dropped dramatically over the past couple of years, the rate of death, the number of deaths, has remained steady. As the deaths rise in South Texas, we are also being asked for guidance. Both Humane Borders and other organizations are being asked for guidance. Regrettably, Southern Arizona has the most experience in America with migrant deaths. This spring, we were able to launch an interactive website in partnership with the county's medical examiner's office that provides layers of information about verified migrant deaths in southern Arizona, and that has been useful information to the medical examiner's office, researchers, public, and the families of missing loved ones. We very much would like to get out of this business. There is no question about it. It's very hard to prove statistically exactly who uses the stations and how many lives it saves. We do know, for an example, that the life of an 11-year-old girl was saved when she was separated from her group and she remembered where the station was and went back to that. And we have other anecdotal examples. But it is a tragic situation, and I think we all agree that we need to fix this. The federal government needs to fix this situation. In the meantime, we need to take care of the people that are dying in our backyard. Personally, I'm grateful to live in a county that addresses this issue, and on behalf of Humane Borders, I ask that you approve the contract.
Thank you. Any questions from the board? All right, hearing none, the next speaker will be Jerry Payton. Mr. Payton, please come up, identify yourself for the record, and you have 3 minutes.
Good morning, my name is Jerry Payton. My address is 2382 East Precious Yard Court, and that's in Oro Valley. I'm the founder and executive director of Sold No More, formerly Streetlight Tucson. We're an anti-trafficking NGO here. I'm also the organizing head of the Southern Arizona Human Trafficking Task Force. I brought together law enforcement personnel from every municipal, federal, state, a law enforcement agency here, as well as all three prosecutor's offices. And it was Supervisor Miller who suggested that I make these comments during this item on the agenda, although I'm not arguing for or against the funding of the water stations, but the need for better anti-trafficking laws. The report was released yesterday, published in Phoenix from Polaris Project. Arizona once again ties for the third worst human trafficking laws in the country. We are not doing enough. If you talk to people who work on the border, as I do, because I head up the task force, the women who come across, who are smuggled across, the coyotes don't just take money to smuggle them. They then collect money from the men who come down in pickup trucks to rape them in mass. I've seen the pictures of the rape trees with the women's undergarments hanging down along the borders. That's welcome to America. What was a human smuggling becomes a human trafficking. They come across the border and they're being sold before they even get to Tucson. Because we don't have laws, including tough enough laws in Pima County, we're not addressing what's happening to these people. And one reason is we don't call it human trafficking. We've had 6 cases this year already in Pima County of child sex trafficking, not one of which has been labeled legally as child sex trafficking. It's been labeled as pandering, child prostitution. So we don't have a child sex trafficking problem here. But we are arresting juvenile victims, and they have a record as prostitutes. We do not have safe harbor laws here. Earlier this year, I was in Pima County Juvenile Court speaking on behalf of a 16-year-old who was on trial as a felon for resisting arrest. She was resisting arrest because she was dropped off at a hotel after having been sold. And no one in the court mentioned the fact that she's being sold by a 35-year-old man, had been raped by when she was 15, and 16 by adult men. She was about to become a convicted felon. But because I was able to explain to the court what had happened to her, they dropped all the felony charges. But here's where the county comes in. Afterwards, the prosecuting attorney, I've had great work with the Pima County Prosecutor's Office, came out to me and thanked me for killing her case. She said, we don't want to convict 16-year-olds as felons when they're trafficking victims. We need to change the process here, the trafficking laws and process for these victims, so they don't go to court and become convicted. So I would ask you to, on a future agenda, address the specific child sex trafficking and human trafficking issues here in Pima County, especially how they're being handled in the courts and in the Pima County Sheriff's Office. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Payton. Any questions?
I just want to thank you for bringing it to our attention.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Rezalias.
Before we vote, I would just comment that the gentleman makes a good point, and certainly if crossing the border is the first crime in all of this mess that we have related to this migration phenomena, then it's true that sexual assault is the second crime that happens along the border. And we've known this for years. This is not a surprise. This is one of the more horrible aspects of why we need to resolve the issue related to immigration in our country. But while we're saying that, I would also add that our forensic science office has done an excellent job and really needs to be the model for the entire border region as to how to deal with these deaths that take place in the desert and the humanitarian aid that's placed out in the desert by Humane Borders should be a model also. And I think that it's incumbent on all of us to contact our congresspeople and let them know, out of the hundreds of billions of dollars being included in the current immigration bill, several billion of those dollars should be spent on humanitarian aid. That's border security.
Any other comments? Hearing none, the motion before us is on the approval of item number 11. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay.
No.
By your vote of 3-1, motion carries. I'm going to go ahead and move to addendum item 14, 15, and 16. And then we'll follow that with executive session.
Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Elias.
Do we have any speakers on these items?
I have one speaker. But I was going to ask Mr. Huckleberry why to open it up. No?
Mr. Chairman, this is the same item that we've discussed on several occasions in the past with regard to leveraging our investments to improve financial returns to the hospital systems in Pima County. And in particular, this one is offsetting the cost of what we call uncompensated care, and is a strategy that can and has been used by others throughout the country with regard to increasing the reimbursements and the fiscal stabilities of our hospital system, particularly as they experience increased cost in areas of uncompensated care due to the fiscal stresses associated with the economy, as well as the changing environment with regard to medical and health insurance. We're recommending that the board approve the item that basically allows this investment with a corresponding investment in capital infrastructure the county is building associated with, in this particular case, the loop, the Julian Wash, and this is the culmination of some planning that's probably taken place over the last year, and this is really our second or third type investment related to this. The first with regard to the University of Arizona South Campus, the second with Tucson Medical Center, and the now successful and open indoor sports facility, Sporting Chance, and now the loop. If you'd be happy to answer any questions, we recommend the action.
Mr. Chairman,
Supervisor Miller.
I still have a level of discomfort with this because of the fact that this Julian Wash improvements were originally identified with bond monies, and moving this bond money, whether it's into the general fund to be able to move it over here, I still have questions relating to that, that these were bond projects initially, and that has never been clearly, it was in the 2013-14 budget still identified as bond projects, these particular projects. There are meeting minutes that we have retrieved that show that they were bond projects, so that's where my level of discomfort is moving bond monies. We have specific rules on moving these bond monies, and this does not comply with those rules. Thank you.
Please respond to that.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, we've sent the board, I think, a detailed explanation by segment with regard to the funding sources used for the entire Julian Wash. The Julian Wash segment is really probably 20-plus miles long, basically stopping at its intersection with the Santa Cruz River and then really originating just beyond the Science and Tech Park. Portions of that facility have already been completed and open to pedestrian, bicycle, and river park traffic. Those are the sections using bonds. There's another section that is using bonds in the Santa Cruz River project that's now under contract, so those are bonds. And so we've used a mixture of revenues, which is very typical in very large projects that span the space of multiple years of implementation and geographically 10 to 20 miles. And so we've disclosed on numerous occasions the exact use of revenues by segment, and this simply is using the general fund allocations that were allocated to the segments that have been the most difficult to construct and took the longest to actually develop over time. So there's really nothing new about funding sources with regard to these segments of the Julian Wash.
I do have one speaker. I'm going to go ahead and call her up. Julia Strange, please come up, identify yourself for the record, and you have 3 minutes.
Hello, my name is Julia Strange. I'm Vice President of Community Benefit for Tucson Medical Center, and I'm here representing also the Community Healthcare Benefit Foundation of Pima County that includes Tucson Medical Center and Carondelet. We would thank you for considering these items that address two critical needs in our community. Our collaborative community health needs assessment shows that access to care and access to opportunities for physical activity are two areas that we need to focus on to improve the overall health of the community, and today's action would address both of those. So I thank you for your leadership on behalf of the staff, the leadership, the staff, the physicians of Tucson Medical Center and Carondelet, and look forward to working further with the county. The staff has been terrific, and you have a terrific organization and terrific staff that has really provided great leadership, and we've appreciated working with them. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions?
Thank you. Mr. Chairman? I was just going to make a comment that I think this is a very creative way of bringing more money into our community to help protect our hospitals and to make sure that those folks who remain uninsured have the best care available to them. This is about saving lives in our community. This is about doing the right thing. This is about government being creative and working together with the private sector to make things happen. I certainly appreciate our partners at TMC. Done a great job, and we hope to continue being able to work cooperatively with you in the future.
Mr. Chairman, I echo Supervisor Elias's comments. This is a public-public as well as public-private partnership. It's this type of collaboration that allows us to achieve our goals in a fiscally responsible way, and I applaud our partners in this. And with that, I'm going to move items 14, 15, and 16.
Second. Motion and a second to approve item number 14, 15, and 16 on the addendum agenda. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, please signify by saying nay.
No.
By your vote of 4-1, motion carries. Chair will entertain a motion to go into executive session.
So moved.
Motion and a second to go into executive session. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. We will recess to the sound of the gavel at the end of exec. Call this meeting back to order. We had several items on the executive session calendar. Council, please.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Item number three on the addendum agenda concerns DPL Park, Inc. versus Pima County, Arizona Tax Court Case Number TX-2012-714. This litigation involves a two-story motel located at 1031 East Benson Highway in Tucson. The proposed settlement would result in estimated tax decreases based upon 2012 tax rates of $37,225 for tax year 2012 and $36,290 for tax year 2013. The values for tax year 2013 will roll over to tax year 2014 pursuant to the statute. County attorney and the county assessor recommend the settlement.
Move the county attorney and assessor's recommendation.
Motion and a second to approve the county attorney and assessor's recommendation. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Council?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Item number five on the addendum agenda, item four being pulled already. We're going to item five on the addendum agenda concerns Orange Grove Off Condo ENT LLC versus Pima County, Arizona Tax Court Case Number ST-2012-792. This litigation involves two partially completed office condo units, units 101 and 103, located at 1238 West Orange Grove Road in unincorporated Pima County. The assessor's office and county attorney's office recommend settlement as follows. For unit 101, the proposed settlement would result in an estimated tax decreases based upon 2012 tax rates of $7,545 for the 2012 tax year and $2,435 for the 2013 tax year. For unit 103, for tax year 2012, the proposed settlement would result in an estimated tax decrease based on 12 rates of $10,495 for the 2012 tax year and $3,385 for the 2013 tax year. Per agreement of the parties, the settlement values for tax year 13 on both parcels will not roll over to tax year 2014. Again, we recommend the settlement.
Recommendation.
Motion and a second to approve the county attorney and assessor's recommendation. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Council?
Yes. Item number six on the addendum agenda, Mr. Chairman, concerns Tin Cup Properties LLC versus Pima County, Arizona Tax Court Case Number ST-2012-749 in the Arizona Tax Court. This litigation involves a warehouse property located at 2626 South 4th Avenue in South Tucson. The proposed settlement would result in an estimated tax decreases, and these are for 2 years taxes, tax years 12 and 13. The tax decreases would be in 2012, based on those rates, would be $21,750 for tax year 2012 and $21,205 for tax year 2013. The values for tax year 2013 will roll over to 2014 pursuant to the statute. However, the parties specifically have agreed that the county assessor may send and will be sending a supplemental notice of value and notice of change for tax year 2014. The county attorney's office and again the county assessor's office recommend this proposed settlement.
Move the county attorney and assessor's recommendation.
Motion and second to approve the county attorney and assessor's recommendation. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Council?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, item seven on the addendum agenda concerns Tucson 5 LP versus Pima County, Arizona Tax Court Case Number TX-2011-923 in the Arizona Tax Court. This litigation involves an apartment complex located at 6340 South Santa Clara Avenue in Tucson. The proposed settlement would result in an estimated tax decrease of $7,570 for tax year 2012. The value established by the assessor for 2012 will roll over to tax year 2013 pursuant to the statute. The assessor and the county attorney's office recommend this proposed settlement.
Move the county attorney and assessor's recommendation.
Second.
Motion and second to approve the county attorney and assistant recommendation. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it, Council.
Yes, item 8 on the addendum agenda, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, concerns Tucson Mather Plaza LLC, a limited liability company, DBA Splendido at Rancho Vistoso versus Pima County, Arizona Tax Court case numbers 2012-63 and 2012-540. This is for both tax years 2012 and 13. This litigation involves an adult health care complex located on the east side of Rancho Vistoso Boulevard, north of the intersection of Moore Road in the Rancho Vistoso development. The proposed settlement would result in estimated tax decreases based on 2012 tax rates of $101,490 for tax year 2012 and $90,820 for tax year 2013. The values for tax year 2013 will roll over to tax year 2014 pursuant to the statute. The county attorney and the assessor recommend this proposed settlement.
Move the county attorney and assessor's recommendation.
Second. Motion and second to approve the county attorney's recommendation, county attorney and assessor's recommendation on item number 8. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Council.
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, executive session item number 9 on the addendum agenda was for information only. It relates to legal advice on item 8 on the regular agenda. Executive session item 10 on the addendum agenda concerns the county's claim for excess costs related to water service to the new Justice Court complex. The county attorney and the county administrator seek authority to proceed as discussed in executive session.
Move the county attorney and administrator's recommendation to proceed as discussed in exec.
Motion and second to approve the county attorney and administrator's recommendations to proceed as instructed in executive session. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Moving on to the board of supervisors sitting as other boards, library district board, item number 5.
Mr. Chairman, I'll move the item.
Second.
Motion and second to approve item number 5 on the regular agenda. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye. All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Board of Supervisors sitting in regular session. Consent calendar. I do not have any cards to speak on a consent calendar item only. Is there anyone here who would like to address the board on a consent calendar item? Hearing none, what's the will of the board
Mr.
on the
Chairman,
consent calendar? Mr. Resilius.
I'll move consent as written.
Second. Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Miller.
I'd like to pull consent calendar item 1 and vote on that one separately.
Second.
That is the, okay.
Does the maker and a seconder withdraw their motion?
I'll withdraw my motion.
Okay.
I'll second the motion to separate item 1.
All right, so is there a motion on item number 1 on the consent calendar?
Mr. Chairman, I had a lot of questions about this item. This contract actually commenced in February, and it's just now coming before the board. And that was one question I had for the, I guess, the county administrator. And then I would like to know, what was the process for selecting this individual? What are the qualifications? Was there a competitive bidding process? This is a $40,000 contract. For consulting and working on community service type issues. And it is my understanding this individual lives in Phoenix, and we have a lot of organizations working in Pima County, a lot of individuals in Pima County working on this type of work from what I've seen on the various organizations. So I have researched this, and I was wondering if there's any information on, first of all, why is this coming before us when it was this contract commenced in February?
Ms. Ogilvie?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I believe Mr. Atha can answer the questions regarding this contract.
Mr. Atha?
Mr. Chairman, Supervisor Miller, the fact that the contract is so late is simply a problem with delay in my office and in negotiating the contract with the contractor. and I have no good explanation for that. It's just a problem that I created by not getting to this earlier. As far as the this contract, it is a direct select procurement approved by the county administrator. It was not bid competitively. Well, I take that back. Originally there was a bid about 4 years ago for this, but this particular contract is a direct select contract, and it is the individual has particular expertise in some of the areas that that my departments work with. He is a former director of workforce training for the Department of Economic Security with a great deal of expertise in the state policies and federal policies regarding Department of Economic Security programs. He's been very useful to us in a number of ways. Most recently, been very useful in dealing with some helping us with some proposed changes by the Department of Economic Security in the administration of overall state administration of the workforce system.
So we don't have an individual here in Pima County that could do this type of work?
Not with the particular unique expertise that this individual has, no.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Item 5 was.
Item 5 was amended?
Yes.
Yeah. I don't see it on here.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, Supervisor Lewis.
Well, I'm not going to piddle about that because I'm just going to go ahead and move consent agenda as amended.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve consent as amended. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Moving on to item number 8.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. 8,
Mr. Chairman. Mr. Isaac.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. Under item number 8, I'd like to go ahead and ask when the meeting, 30 days, I'd like to schedule this for a continuation for 30 days from now on item number 8, the Colossal Cave Mountain Park issue.
That's in the form of a motion, I'll second.
It is in the form of a motion. I had one comment to make that often there are parallel investigations that occur. This is just a direction for Mr. Huckleberry to continue and to begin administratively some of the things discussed as we did in executive session so mentioned. Thank you very much. I move the delay for 30 days. What would that date be, the clerk?
September
10th. Sounds perfect. Thank you so much, and I appreciate all the assistance.
Second.
Mr. Chairman?
Supervisor Elias.
I would just like to comment that I support Wildcats.
We all do. Thank you, Mr. Elias.
Motion before us is on item number 8, a 30-day continuance to the September 10th board meeting. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Moving on to item 9, Pima Council on Aging.
Thank you for being so patient. I know it's gone slow this morning. It's 11 o'clock and we're barely
morning,
getting
Dr.
to
Evans.
Item 9
morning,
on the
Mr.
agenda,
Carroll.
But we appreciate your patience.
Dr. Evans, if you could please identify yourself.
Yes, I'm Dr. Palmer Evans. I'm the chairman of the Pima Council on Aging Board of Directors, and I'd like to discuss with you the daunting task of meeting the needs of the aging population in this area. Today we're bringing information, not asking for money, so you can relax a little bit. We're here to ask you for your continuing cooperation in a collaborative regional approach to address issues affecting the growing aging population and their caregivers. And I'd like to thank you for the partnership PCOA and the county have enjoyed for many years. In the mid-70s, if I could have the first slide there, in the mid-70s, the county asked PCOA to analyze and recommend ways in which the county could plan for the needs of our older residents. This resulted in a plan for long-term care services that incorporated 18 major recommendations, many of which the county has implemented over the years, particularly the systems for long-term care services. Next slide, please. Now, the county previously supported this. Recent discussions with Ms. Pivarata and Dr. Garcia have explored ways to collaborate again to maximize the resources of PCOA and the county. Today, we address the needs of the aging in our community and developing plans for the future. I'd like to introduce you to somebody who needs no introduction and is very familiar to all of you, Jim Murphy, the Chief Executive Officer of PCOA, to tell you more about the needs assessment process PCOA conducted recently in the resulting document, Aging in Pima County, a report to the community, which you all received a copy of. Jim? I think we need to go to the next slide.
I don't think those slides are coming up over there. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you very much for giving us time today. I know your agenda is long, and I'll try to keep this to the half hour that I have.
We should, now that he's talking about speaking for half an hour, we should note that Jim was a former member of the Board of Supervisors.
But he was a lot shorter back then.
First, most of you know about Pima Council on Aging. Next slide, please. I just wanted to kind of reinforce the fact that we're 45 years old and we're not as well known as we should be. But the major thing is that we're an area agency on aging. And I know we don't talk about this a lot. We're part of a national network of 650 local area agencies on aging charged under the Older Americans Act of Congress and designated here in Pima County to be an advocate for older adults, to do planning, to provide services, and to be the local go-to agency. Next slide. Just very quickly, some things that I think all of us know. Each and every day starting last year, 10,000 individuals turned 65. Boomers and those over 65 make up 43% of the population of Pima County. Almost half of the population of Pima County are boomers and olders. Suicide rates for Arizona 65 and over are higher than the national average, and Arizona unfortunately ranks 11th in the rate of national food insecurity for seniors. Next slide. Aging is disproportionately a woman's issue. 70% of adults over 85 are women. Elderly women are more likely to live alone. Many women can expect to be widows for 15 to 20 years, so there's significant implications. Next slide. You probably have some data more recent than this because you update more than just the 2010 census. But if you look at the population growth in Pima County in the 10 years from 2000 to 2010, population in Pima County rose 16.2%. Those 60 plus rose 36.9%, 65 plus 26%, and 85 plus 52%. True, the numbers in that 85 plus are small, but those individuals who are 60, 65 are moving into the categories every day. Next slide. Every 3 or 4 years, we do a needs assessment, try to find out what the needs of the older adults in Pima County are. Last year, we invited all the governmental entities, the foundations, United Way, all those agencies that do planning and allocation of resources to join us, to look at our survey instruments, to add to that. And we had a three-part process. First of all, we had focus groups with professionals to say, what do you see in your area as the needs? What are the issues that need to be addressed? We had surveys throughout Pima County, and we had 2,300 surveys returned, which is a very high percentage. And we had 10 public comment meetings from Green Valley to Oro Valley, and everywhere in between. We had several with Spanish interpreters, particularly on the south and west side. Next slide. We use this, next slide. Next slide. We use this for a variety of reasons. It identifies the demographics. It brings out the critical areas within the community, identifies the best practices, and it presents issues that we need to address for the future. Next slide. If you look at page 36 and 37 in the report, But I have a quick slide here that compares both those who reported a serious problem and those reported some problem. And I always like to look at the some problems and the serious together, because it's some problem today, it's going to be a serious problem unless addressed. And you can see how these fell between fear of falling, memory loss, affordable dental care, maintaining and repairing my home, transportation costs, and a variety of the other services. Next slide. The age of the respondents is not necessarily significant. The 60 to 69 were the highest in terms of responses. Next slide. Living arrangements, I think, is significant in that of those treated 2,300 who reported, 52% live alone. It's a significant and points to the fact that probably more resources are needed. Next slide. In this slide, you'll see that individuals who responded to the survey, over half have lived in Pima County more than 21 years. And also those who have lived in their current residence, more than half have lived in their current residence for over 21 years. We have a lot of longtime residents who are, we're all aging, but present different kinds of problems. Next slide. In the past, in the past year, individuals have fallen 1 to 2 times and greater, 30-some percent of the population has fallen 1 or more times. Next, the ability to maintain and repair homes. Again, this goes back to the number of elderly, the number of living in their home for many years. 30% are having difficulty maintaining their own homes. Next slide. Transportation, always one of the largest issues for older adults, particularly, I guess, the old. Nobody knows what old is today. Old is 10 years older than I am for me. So I don't know what it is for everybody else, but it's something that nobody can agree on who's old or what is the age. But according to the respondents, and not unusual, 71% say they are still driving and own their own vehicle, and that's kind of scary sometimes. And there are many individuals who can't give up driving, even though they should, because they have no options. And that's something we really need to address as a community, finding ways to get people off the street who shouldn't be driving and give them an opportunity not to have to be in their home all the time. The number of people receiving rides from faith communities and volunteers is around 5%. That's an area I think we can work together to make that much higher and give much more assistance to older adults who should be getting out of the house. Next slide. Reasons for transportation, as you might know, 88% medical, 70% groceries, and 53% prescriptions. Obviously for other reasons, but those are key issues that we need to, as a community and as a region, help people be able to get out. The next slide, please. There are many other issues, obviously, in our study. Fear of falling has been mentioned, home repair, income insecurity, meals, in-home assistance. Next slide, and I'm going through this very quickly. You have data in the report, though. In terms of the professional focus groups and the public comment meetings, it confirms pretty much what is in the respondents of the 2,300. The clients are more vulnerable. They're struggling economically. They need more assistance in the past because they're older on an average than our population has been. More people living with chronic conditions and dementia. More support for grandparents raising grandkids, a growing issue, again, that we need to address as a community and on a regional basis. And more adults with behavioral health problems. Next slide, please. Where do we go from here, I think, is the issue. As a result of the data that we've gathered through this process and our everyday work with boomers, older adults, and their families, and further discussions with planning bodies, we will develop our 2014 to 17 area plan on aging for Pima County. It's one part of our strategic plan. It talks about services and addressing those needs. The other part talks about the administration and the management of our resources. We don't want to do this in a vacuum. That's why we invited all the governmental entities to be part of the committee and to help us and getting information out to the public and in evaluating the responses. Dr. Evans noted in the opening remarks that we are not here to ask for money, but to encourage you today to join us and provide leadership on a regional basis, because we don't think this should be done piecemeal, you know, by Marana and Oro Valley and the county and unincorporated areas and so forth. That somehow we want you to help us bring together kind of a collaborative approach. We again invited all of the jurisdictions to help us get information out, but the other idea was to go behind the data that we've been able to pull out in the report we gave you today. There's much more data there. The only agency so far, and to the credit of the county, has been Pima County. And Dr. Francisco Garcia and his staff have gone into our database and pulled out much more information than we have in the report we gave you today. And he's excited about being able to use some of that information. When we make this offer, we've been before the mayor and council, we're going before the Marana Town Council tomorrow night, and we'll be going before Oro Valley to talk about coming together to address these issues on a regional basis. So we appreciate the time you gave us today. We hope we'll have some continuing discussions about the data and how we might develop the kinds of private partnerships that you talked about earlier today in the social service arena, the way you held in the health industry arena.
Supervisor Brunson?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I would also encourage you, you're going to the various cities and towns and asking for their assistance in collaborative efforts. You might also, particularly as it relates to transportation, because I think that's a major, major issue that no one is really addressing. And with the chairman's concurrence, perhaps a presentation to PAG of this information, because they are involved in transit. But right. Pima Association
Chairman,
of Governments.
Yes. Yeah. Supervisor, I think that's an excellent idea. We have not approached PAG. As I said, we are meeting individually. We have a meeting tomorrow night with the Marana Town Council. We've met with the city of Tucson, and we're trying to Oro Valley and Sarita, but before PAG, if you can arrange that, we'd be happy to, and maybe have a little more time to talk.
Okay. Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Elias.
I'd just like to comment that, well, number one, thank PCOA for the work that they do in our community. It's so valuable to us, we could not enumerate all the valuable things that PCOA does for us all and for all our families. And I, for one, am very appreciative of that, and I think you're a great organization just based on that. An amazing amount of revenue has been lost by PCOA over the last several years, including the community services program that Pima County used to offer based on proceeds from the Pima health systems. That's been a huge detriment, and thousands of elders in our community eat less and frankly have fewer baths. And anybody who has an elder relative knows that that's a very difficult situation to be in, but I'm particularly not shocked, but it adds to my concern the high number of people who have serious problems maintaining their residence in their homes right now and being able to take care of their homes. That is a huge number that is going to cost us millions of dollars in our community into the future as we continue on, because one of those keys to our elders and keeping those costs down is making sure that they can live in their home safely and comfortably and in a healthy home. All those things are very complicated. So, you know, that just, I should reiterate to everybody that we have to find a methodology to replacing those dollars that have been lost by PCOA over the last several years. And for all the providers who help our elders in our community, this is not something that any of us should take lightly. It is very serious indeed. And we have to find a pathway to replacing those dollars that have been lost through various decisions in government, for the most part, let's be honest, as well as private donations, and people aren't quite as able to give as they have been in the past. So, of course, asking people to be generous is an important part of it, but recognize that just simply is not going to be enough. So, anyways, just wanted to reinforce the comments that Jim has made here today, and your president, thank you for coming here as well. Appreciate it, Jim.
Thank you.
Thank you both.
Thank you.
Moving on to item number 10, waiver of assessed penalties.
I'll move the item.
I believe the clerk may have. Okay. All right, there's a motion and a second to approve item number 10. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. I'm going to skip real quickly to item number 18. I believe the clerk has a comment.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, the assessor has withdrawn his appeal of the review officer's decision, and the review officer's decision will stand.
So we take no action then?
Correct.
Thank you.
Okay. Quickest number 18 we've had in a long time. All right, going back to number 12, 13,
you mean
and 14.
They were sitting here all this time waiting for us. We're sorry.
It was only Bill.
Yeah, we apologize to Beth,
Beth,
not
there,
Bill.
Oh.
Yeah, you better not miss that one.
All right, moving on to item 12, 13, and 14, and resolutions number 2013-70 through 72.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Rezalias.
I'll go ahead and move items 12 through 14, resolutions 2013-70, 71, and 72.
Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Miller.
I thought we removed item 13. Did I get that wrong?
15.
Item 15.
15. Okay. Okay. Sorry. Got that wrong. Second.
Okay, I do have a speaker card that wants to talk about the field naming policy. Right, the county naming policy. I'm going to call him up at this point. You have 3 minutes.
Does that relate to number 15 or does it?
13.
13. Okay.
That's fine.
Please come up. You have 3 minutes. Please identify yourself for the record.
My name is Christopher Cole. I reside at 4357 East Pima Street in Tucson. Mr. Chairman, you may remember several meetings ago, under call of the audience, I brought up the idea of naming various buildings and so forth for veterans. And at the time, you said that since it was not an agenda item, there was very little that could be done at the time. I've noticed it's never come up under the agenda. So I don't know the individual who the field is being named for, nor the other individuals that places are being named for. So I have a question, Mr. Chairman, and it's not rhetorical. Are they veterans?
I don't know, sir.
I don't.
Were veterans even considered? Again, this is not rhetorical.
What I believe that happened is that these recommendations came through our Parks Commission. So I don't know the answer to that.
I was expecting something, that sort of an answer, sir. I do ask that the county consider veterans, because not only do veterans do wonderful work in the community, they have served this country and at the risk of their lives. If these individuals are veterans, I'm going to be presuming that there is going to be a biographical plaque put up at these locations. If these individuals are veterans, is their veterans status and their honorable service going to be celebrated? Can that be done? It should be done. Please, Mr. Chairman, do something about the naming conventions so that veterans are given a fair shake, and that when some place is named after a veteran, their veterans status is celebrated. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Chair, entertain a motion. All right, the motion before us is on the approval of item 12 through 14 on resolutions number 2013-70 through 72. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Hearings. Item number 16, tax levy resolution. Yes. I do have a speaker card, so why don't I go ahead and go to the speaker card at this point. Mr. Cole, would you please come up and identify yourself for the record again?
You should have stayed there.
Well, I didn't know I was going to be the next person up. My name is Christopher Cole, and I reside at 4357 East Pima Street in Tucson. I have been authorized by the Pima County Libertarian Party to give an official comment on the tax levy that the Pima County Board of Supervisors is considering today. There's been talk of raising the levy to a point where the dollar amount coming into the Pima County government is the same as it was previously. The Pima County Libertarian Party is against doing such, since doing so is to make the claim that Pima County has more right to a person's money than the person does. This is an attitude which should not exist in any government official, but unfortunately exists in far too many government officials at all levels of government. One reason that you may consider this action is that because the real estate market is still depressed and therefore revenue coming in is somewhat less. The intent is that the dollar amount that a property owner would pay would be the same under the new rates as under the old rates. And thus, the amount the property owner pays would be unchanged. Unfortunately, it will not remain unchanged. As the real estate market recovers, the dollar amount will increase. Wages have not recovered from the recession and will lag for months, if not years to come, even if the recovery becomes more robust than it presently is. This means a lot of people at the lower end of the economic scale will be hurt by such a rise in the dollar amount before their income rises to cover the imposition by Pima County. There are a lot of people who live on the edge now. Any increase in expenses unmatched by increases in income could easily prove disastrous. Those who own homes may end up getting foreclosed. Yes, many are that close to disaster even now. Rental property owners may have to face increasing rents or depriving their own families and employees. Stock companies may have to raise prices or deprive their stockholders. And those stockholders, more often than not, are pension plans or nonprofits or other such institutions. The days of the rich individual stockholders, such as the Kennedys or Nancy Pelosi, are pretty much over. The stock market is pretty much the field of 401k plans, union pensions, and so forth. If companies have to deprive their stockholders, these are the ones that are being deprived, not some faceless corporation, however easy such might be as a target. And remember that your tax increase is not the only increase the taxpayer will face. The Pima County Libertarian Party urges the Board of Supervisors to hold the tax levy at its present rate and not increase it. But if you do decide to increase it, the Pima County Libertarian Party urges you to ensure that the rate decreases as the market increases so that the poor are not hurt. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Chairman.
Sir Azaleas.
Mr. Huckleberry. I was just noticed listening to Mr. Cole, and I understand his point, and I don't want to be argumentative with him, because I think he's a very nice gentleman, and I think he's presented his case well. But during the real estate bubble of the 2000s, Pima County did exactly what Mr. Cole suggested, and actually reduced the tax levy during those years to create, quote, revenue neutral budgets as a means of protecting people, because we realized that this was not going to last. I was just looking for some verification of that, Chuck, see if you remembered those numbers right off the top of your head, because I know you're good at that.
Mr. Huckleberry.
Yes, Mr. Chairman and Supervisor Elias, it's in attachment B to the memorandum. And it actually shows that in 2004 and 5, really 10 years ago, our primary rate was $4.07. During the incline or the increase in assessed values, it went through 6, 7, 8, and 9. And partially into 10, we dropped that rate from $4.07 to $3.31. And so there's a corresponding decrease in the rate to achieve the amount of tax levy necessary to operate county government. So, and if you then look at the corresponding tax rates of all of our secondaries, and I have to there are 94 separate taxing jurisdictions in Pima County. The board has control over four of those rates, And then if you look at the library district and flood control and debt service, they all did similar declines during that period. Debt service went from 81 cents down to as low as 60 cents during that period. Our library district was the exception because it went up, because in 2005 we assumed the entire burden of financially financing the entire regional system. And flood control went from 35 cents down to what it is today at 26 cents. And it stayed level at 26 cents through this recession, primarily because we have not incurred any flood disasters since the floods of, say, about a decade ago.
Other questions?
I would just like to make a comment, Mr. Chairman, if I may. I am not going to support this tax levy resolution because of the fact that we increased spending for next year. And I don't believe that we looked at this budget closely enough to reduce spending in order to put more money in the pockets of the taxpayers. And I wanted to make that comment before we voted. Thank you.
Thank you. What's the will of the board?
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to move, if there are no more speakers, that we close the public hearing and approve resolution 2013-74 in the adoption of the fiscal year 2013-2014 tax rates, establishing the tax levy amounts for the primary general fund, the general fund, that amount will be $3.6665 for a levy of $277,155,468. For the County Free Library District, that rate will be 0.3753. For a levy of $28,487,320. For debt service, at setting the rate at 0.7800. For a levy of $59,464,792. For flood control district, a rate of 0.2635. And a levy of $17,834,883. Fire district assistance tax, again, which we don't set, but a rate of 0.0456 for a levy of $3,476,404. So the entire levy for the total county for fiscal year 2013-14 will be $386,418,867, and the effective rate of $5.1309.
Second.
Motion and second to approve item number 16 and resolution number 2013-74. Roll call vote.
Supervisor Bronson?
Aye.
Supervisor Carroll?
No.
Supervisor Elias?
Aye.
Supervisor Miller?
No.
Chairman Valadez?
Aye. By your vote of 3-2, motion carries. Moving on to item number 17, tax collection resolution, resolution 2013-75.
Once again, this is a hearing. Is there anyone in the audience that wishes to address us on this item at this time? If not, I'm going to move we close public hearing and approve tax collection resolution 2013-75.
Motion and a second to approve item number 17, tax collection resolution number 2013-75. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. We've already done item number 18. We are moving on to franchise license permits, items 19 through 22.
Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Elias.
I'm going to go ahead and move that we I've seen no one come forward to speak to any of these items. These are public hearings. Nobody coming forward. I'm going to move to close the public hearings, approve items 19, 20, 21, and 22.
Second.
Motion and a second to close the public hearing and approve item 19, 20, 21, and 22. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 All opposed, please signify by saying nay. I'm going to go ahead at this point and take a 10-minute recess. And we'll return to sound of the gavel. Call this meeting back to order. You're welcome. And we're going to go a little out of order again, and we're going to item number 20 on the addendum agenda. Traffic ordinance, ordinance number 2013-41. It is a hearing. We have a speaker. His Mr. Bob Milby. Mr. Milby, please come up. Identify yourself for the record. You have 3 minutes.
Thank you. My name is Bob Milby, and I live at 8064 North Wayward Star Drive in Tucson, District 3. I stand here today in opposition to the way that proposed ordinance 2013-41 is currently drafted. I urge you to not simply accept what is in front of you, as I believe the proposed ordinance is reactionary and an overreach. Pick up and drop off at Legacy Traditional School is a mess. Of this, there is little doubt. From either the parents of the students or the communities immediately surrounding the school, the area has been in constant upheaval with the addition of Legacy and the Cortero Farms Road construction effort. That said, emotions run high on this issue. Nearby residents have asked their HOA to pressure the Pima County DOT and this board to respond to their grievances. According to email submissions, which are public record, most seem to be consistently centered on three things: inconvenience, emergency vehicle access, and driver visibility. I would like to address each of these in the time I have left. Inconvenience, although an irritant, should not be in and of itself be actionable by a body such as this. At the end of the day, we're all members of a community. Just as one cannot legislate morality, it's a fool's errand to attempt regulating cooperation. That's the responsibility of the community itself. This board should encourage the entities within its purview to actively seek resolution to this by working directly with the community and the school, rather than just react to the loudest or squeakiest wheel. Currently, the Pima County DOT and Legacy Traditional School have a meeting scheduled. I understand that not only are the school and the DOT going to be present, but I believe the Pima County Sheriff's Office, as well as the HOA, are also going to be there. This meeting will take place on September 26th. I ask each of you to let this process work and to table the proposed ordinance in deference to those parties. In my email to each of you, you all received one from me, I suggested what I believe to be a viable and thoughtful alternative to both the safety issues, emergency vehicle access and visibility. And that note, which is attached to your addendum, I propose that 2013-41 be rewritten to only include the west side of Paseo del Rancho Escondido, rather than both sides of the street. This addresses street width, as even parking along the east side of the street would still allow for bi-directional through traffic, as Paseo del Rancho Escondido is wider than the surrounding streets. This is apparent to the unaided eye if you take a look at the Google map that Supervisor Miller, I believe, has prepared, as well as by noting that no one to date has suggested that parking on the side streets be restricted for the reason of emergency access. Visibility at the intersection with Cortero Farms Road is already protected under state statute because you can't park within 30 feet of a stop sign. I realize my time is up. Might I continue to just finish my paragraph?
Please proceed.
I appreciate that. Thank you. Why restrict just the west side? Two reasons. Access. There are no points of ingress or egress on the east side. The east side is bordered by sidewalk, vegetation, and a block wall. Second thing is visibility. The two intersecting roads that come into the main path there that we're talking about are only on the west side. So if you're pulling into one of those streets or pulling out of those streets, you would still have clear visibility in both directions. I was able to confirm with the DOT, and the DOT, by the way, has been very informative and kind. They have confirmed that that was not under consideration when the ordinance was drafted. I ask of you again just to consider tabling this until the discussion can continue with the DOT, the school, the HOA, and the sheriff's office. We need a resolution, but this is not something that I think we can do quickly in one morning. Thank you very much for your time.
Any questions from the board?
Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Miller.
I'd like to ask the Ms. Cornelio from the Department of Transportation to comment.
Ms. Cornelio.
Sure. Mr. Chairman and Supervisor Miller, we have worked, we have a safety problem out there with the Legacy School. We have photos that we've taken recently about the way the parents are parking and blocking the roadway and blocking the traffic. That's why we feel very strongly and urge you to pass the ordinance today, because the Sheriff's Department has been out there. They said they cannot, will not enforce the signage that we have up there right now, and we put the signage up in anticipation of the approval of the ordinance today. What we absolutely commit to, though, is, and we have a meeting scheduled in September with the Homeowners Association, with the school, and the school administration folks from Phoenix are going to come down to participate it with the sheriffs and with the Department of Transportation to come up with a solution that's good for all of them. What we know we've put out right now with the signage is that it's may not be enough. Because of the level of congestion, it's unfortunate that, or fortunate, I suppose, from a business standpoint for the school. But all the traffic impact studies work that was done for about 800 students. We understand that there's over 900 students, and that's one of the reasons that we have an issue out here. And so that's another thing that we're going to be working with the school to provide an updated traffic impact study about what to do with all the additional traffic that was not anticipated. So in sum, I urge you to pass the ordinance today. We, Department of Transportation, commit to go working with, again, the HOA, with the neighbors, with the school, to change and modify the ordinance and the traffic impact studies that we have out there now. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I have some comments as well. One of the things that I've done is provide a, if we could pass that down. Copies of the actual property where this school is, and they have approximately 20 acres, and it appears they have open over close to six and a half acres, and they have room to, provide more parking. And I know that the Department of Transportation has worked diligently trying to work with them, trying to get them to do something about the parking, and my understanding is they haven't been very responsive. I'm glad that this meeting is taking place on the 26th, but from the reports I got from different parents and the letters that I read, there's a real dangerous situation out there with people parking on that other side of the street. That road just opened up, and the car, that there's a lot of traffic, and people are really endangering their lives crossing that street. And the neighborhoods where the people are parking are very congested, and it's causing a lot of problems there. Just because of that, and because of the fact that the Department of Transportation has been trying to work with them, and I think getting this street closed off to private parking on the street, I think will be helpful in getting a resolution more quickly from the school, because I think it is the responsibility of the school to add another entrance and exit, and they certainly have plenty of land. My understanding is they're planning to build a high school there. I have I heard that they are planning to put 9 through 12 in that, and that's what that extra acreage is for. I have not spoken to the authorities at the school, but this was passed on to me by one of the residents in the area. With that, I move to close the public hearing if there aren't any more speakers, and approve the Department of Transportation Traffic Ordinance number 2013-41 of the Board of Supervisors regulating parking on Paseo, Del Rancho, Escondido, and Pima County, Arizona, as recommended by the Department of Transportation staff.
Second.
Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Brunson.
Ms. Cornelio, the ordinance you're proposing, if I understood you correctly, will result in the Sheriff's Office being able to enforce. What if the concerns that the speaker raised, we have some problems between now and September 26th, the day when you're meeting, and we also know that even the meeting on the 26th of September is not going to result in any immediate action to change the ordinance. What if there are problems with the ordinance? How will you address it?
Mr. Chair and Supervisor Bronson, all I can see we do is, again, put up signs like we did right now that we can't enforce, but for the most part, I don't think citizens know that we cannot enforce at that point in time. We will try to move as quickly as we can to take whatever actions that we can. And again, I'm hoping the school will be more receptive to listening to some of our concerns.
What leverage do we have in terms of assuring that the school will listen to our concerns? I mean, if we are doing another traffic impact study, if the information that Supervisor Miller just provided, that that other 20 acres is going to be a high school, the nightmare will continue, and it will be of considerable more intensity than it is with the 900 students now. So again, what's our leverage point, and how do we assure that we get this problem dealt with effectively?
Right. Supervisor Bronson, the Development Services Department has been in contact with the County Attorney's Office and asked to explore what we can do from a legal standpoint, in particular because their traffic impact study that we approved was for 800 students, and we know that they have over 900 students. So again, we're trying to advance from a legal standpoint what our options are also.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Lewis.
Ms. Cornelio, what process have we conducted to notify the public and involve them in this discussion?
Mr. Chairman and Supervisor Elias, in some of our public involvement, I will, this is Lauren Main, I hope not to, and she's our traffic engineer, and she's the one who's been involved in developing the study. So have we had any public involvement as to the development of our plan, of our ordinance?
Yeah, I've been working directly with the HOA manager for the subdivision south of the school, and she has been, you know, relayed several concerns from the homeowners of the area, and those have been relayed to me. And then I have spoke personally to parents of the area as well in regards to the ordinance, so there has been outreach as far as.
But you've conducted no public meetings or chances for people to have their say-so directly to you? You've taken your information secondhand from the HOA manager, is that what I'm to understand?
Yeah, it's been relayed directly from the HOA manager in regards to the.
So you've had no public meetings?
We've had meetings with the school and they.
But that's not a public meeting.
No,
I mean, with real residents in your face, you listening, them listening to you.
No, I have not.
Thank you.
And I think you will have a public, now is the meeting on September 26th a public meeting? And will you notice it? And how will you notice it?
It's currently been involved with the school officials from Phoenix will be coming down, the HOA manager, the sheriff's department, so all those parties will be, we can open that up to, you know, parents as well. We can notify the school.
I think parents of the school need to be notified.
Absolutely.
As well as
yes.
The surrounding subdivisions, the individuals in the surround, not just the homeowners.
Correct.
Association.
Correct.
So if we can get public notice out to them before the 26th.
Absolutely.
Since there is sufficient time.
Absolutely.
Mr. Chairman, one thing that I would like to note is that there has been a significant amount of discussion. There's a group called the Northwest Area Transportation Coalition, and they hold quarterly meetings, and people have been attending those meetings every quarter, and this has been an ongoing issue. If you remember, there was an issue with the left turn lane into the veterinarian's office, specifically because they were being forced to go down and do a U-turn right in front of that school, and due to the increased traffic in this area. And this has been going on for months. I think this was resolved back in February for the veterinarian's office, and the school has, they have done very little to cooperate. I think this meeting will be a good thing, but I don't know what is going to be, how quickly this resolution will come once this meeting happens, or, you know, especially if they're planning to use that additional 6 acres for further development. That is one thing I think we need to clarify, and what kind of congestion that's going to cause. And with that, I will withdraw my motion to hold a public hearing on, and make a motion to close the public hearing and make this September 26th meeting a public hearing and notice it to the public so that the neighbors in the area, in addition to the neighbors that are using, or the folks with their children in the school that are using this area, will in fact have an opportunity to speak out. I will note, however, that I received a tremendous amount of letters from the people that live in this current, in these neighborhoods, that this traffic congestion is just really very difficult to deal with for them. So I am changing my motion. Yes.
Mr. Chairman. Supervisor Elias.
And I appreciate Supervisor Miller's willingness to do that, because I think it's an important facet in this process. Public information and public meeting and direct input is important, and the gentleman here has another suggestion too. But I caution everyone in the area, the parents and the homeowners as well, to take heed at the sheriff's discussion regarding this information. I certainly am loath to vote against the recommendation from the sheriff's office that would improve safety at a school for our children. But it's also important to let people know where we're coming from. So with that, I did want to put that on the record as well, that we definitely take that very serious from the sheriff's office.
Any further discussion? All right, hearing none, before the motion before us is on item number 20, to close the public hearing and make the September 26th meeting a public meeting that is noticed, and that notice go out to neighbors as well as users of the school. Is that correct?
That is correct.
And to approve the ordinance?
I was going to approve the traffic ordinance number 2013-41, okay, so that they can have it there, but we do need this public hearing as well.
Sorry, I missed that. And to approve the ordinance number 2013-41.
Correct.
All right, any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay.
Nay.
By your vote, 4-1, motion carries. Now we'll go back to the regular agenda, item number 23, Pima County Code Text Amendment, ordinance number 2013-37. What's the will of the board? Or Mr. Huckabee, would you like to open it up?
Mr. Chairman.
Which one are we on?
23.
Mr. Chairman, this particular ordinance, all it does is have our definition conform to existing state law.
Did everyone hear that? Okay, what's the will of the board?
I move to approve the Pima County Code Text Amendment Ordinance number 2013-37. And is this a public hearing?
Yes.
Close the public hearing.
Second. Motion before us is on the closing the public hearing and approving item number 23 and ordinance number 2013-37. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Moving on to IA 24 was continued to October 25th. So we've got item number 25, staff report.
Mr. Chairman, this is simply a rezoning ordinance to finalize this particular project, unless there's some questions about it.
Mr. Chairman,
Supervisor Miller.
I move, if there aren't any public speakers, that we close the public hearing and approve the rezoning ordinance number 2013-38, CO9-1301, the 2006 Rupert Family Trust Valley View Road rezoning.
Second.
Motion second to close the public hearing and approve item number 25 and ordinance number 2013-38. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Moving on to item 26 and ordinance number 2013-39.
Mr. Chairman, my understanding is this is the same situation. We're just passing the ordinance for previously approved rezoning. So I move to close the public hearing if there are no speakers and approve ordinance number 2013-39, CO9-57-113, Miller rezoning.
That's not yours?
No, it is not.
No conflict of interest?
No.
Okay.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion and second to approve item number 26 and close the public hearing and approving ordinance number 2013-39, no family relationship. Mm-hmm. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Moving on to item number 27.
Mr. Chairman, if there's no one in the audience that wishes to address us on this item at this time, I move that we close the public hearing and approve resolution 2013-76.
Motion and a second to close public hearing and approve item number 27 and resolution number 2013-76. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Moving on to the addendum agenda, Board of Supervisors, City and Regular Session, Board of Supervisors, request for reconsideration, item number 11. Supervisor Miller.
Mr. Chairman, on August 6, 2013 board meeting, we approved the meeting minutes from the July 2nd board meeting, July 2nd, 2013 Board of Supervisors meeting. These meeting minutes did not accurately reflect the special condition included in my motion for agenda item number 29, that the property owner developer was required to add a slip lane and a right turn deceleration lane. And I move that to reconsider approval of these July meeting minutes.
Second. A motion before us is to reconsider the action as stated by Supervisor Miller. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Supervisor Miller.
I would like to proceed with the reconsideration of the approval of the Board of Supervisors meeting minutes of July 2nd, 2013, specifically to accurately reflect the adopted standard and special conditions that the property owner developer add a slip lane to allow access to the site from northbound Sabino Canyon traffic and a right turn deceleration lane for southbound Sabino Canyon traffic for item number CO9-12-05, Sabino Canyon Gateway LLC, Sabino Canyon Road rezoning.
Mr. Chairman, Supervisor Miller is correct. We did want that slip lane, but as I'm looking at the language she suggested, I still think it is too vague. Mr. Huckleberry, do you have any comments? To accurately reflect.
Yes, Mr. Chairman and Supervisor Bronson, what you can do is
tell you what, let me second that motion for the sake of discussion.
Okay.
Mr. Huckleberry.
I'm sorry.
Mr. Chairman and members of the board, what you can do is simply the owner-developer submitted a site plan at the rezoning that showed the entrance off of Sabino Canyon, and I think all you have to do is say at the location of the entrance of the development is indicated in the site plan as presented at public hearing.
If we could amend the language to include that, I'm fine.
As long as it did, because I recall that he didn't have that in his site plan. It wasn't.
But he had his main entrance in the site plan,
okay.
And that's where the slip plan, slip lane will go. It's right in this throat transition into the double left turn, while there's a little bit of concern.
Okay.
But I think what the problem is if you don't put a slip lane in, all that left turn traffic is going to make U-turns up at the intersection and cause a worse effect.
So okay. We just add your language as
the slip lane at the location of the driveway.
Of the entrance.
Entrance as presented it to the board in the public hearing for the rezoning.
Okay, and the entrance on the site plan, okay. Yeah, if we could amend that language and make
it specific.
Yes,
I agree to amend that language.
Okay, all right.
All right, so any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Contract and award community, item number 12 and 13.
Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Elias.
I'm gonna move items 12 and 13. And I'm also going to move items 17 and 18.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve 12, 13, and 17 and 18. Any discussion?
Mr. Chairman, I had some comments on item 13.
Supervisor Miller.
This is the tax case, and it's a request to continue funding expert witnesses against the Raytheon in a property tax dispute case. And we've already funded this group $50,000 previously, and now the county attorney is requesting another $50,000. My concern here is that we continually talk about supporting Raytheon, keeping Raytheon in the community, and the loss is $1.7 million in tax revenue. And the State Board of Equalization agreed with the Raytheon assessment of $22.5 million versus Pima County's assessment of $40 million. I think this would, when we talk about economic development, the importance of our relationship with Raytheon, and even proposing an aerospace defense corridor around Raytheon to be funded by taxpayers via an upcoming bond election, it really concerns me that we continue to sue one of the largest private employers in southern Arizona. And I remember the meeting where we actually purchased a buffer zone for $6 million around Raytheon at the risk of losing Raytheon for lack of that buffer zone. So my concern is that we are going to continue suing Raytheon for this tax dispute, and we can't forget that Raytheon pays upwards of $130 million in state and local taxes annually. And this, I think this ongoing litigation gives Raytheon mixed messages about our commitment to supporting them here in the community. And I move to deny any further funding of consultation services from the Brecken Nava Group.
You're doing that as a?
As a motion.
As a substitute motion for the motion on the table.
Yes, I am.
Mr. Chairman, I'll go ahead and remove my motion, just so withdraw my motion, so that, you know, they can make this nice and clean.
Okay. And that's fine, because I think I seconded your motion.
Okay.
I'll second the motion. Okay.
Okay. Do you still have a comment?
Excuse me, I have my mic on now. I was going to second to discuss and ask Mr. Huckleberry to explain, and maybe Mr. Straub, first off, the reason for the Brecken Nava Group amendment, and secondly, where we stand on settling with Raytheon over this, and are these there's not a chance to bind these settlements without further court action, so please let me know, Mr. Huckleberry, what your feelings are on this.
Mr. Huckleberry.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, if it was up to me, we would have settled this a long time ago, but it's not. And I think this is the same issue that came to the board previously, that we were very concerned about continuing the litigation. However, we also had to understand the assessor is a separately elected constitutional officer, has some authority to pursue an appeal, which is his choice. And what this, and you're the contracting agency, and so you get put in the untenable position of approving, you know, funding litigation against Raytheon that we really don't approve of, but the assessor has his constitutional right to continue, and so that's all this contract is.
Okay. In the background material, it referenced Pima County specifically, so I guess that included the assessor.
It's the assessor.
Okay. I still move to deny funding the Brecken Nava Group.
There's a motion and a second on the table.
There's a motion and a second. Mr. Straub, what would be the result of denial on this item?
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I certainly understand this is a bitter pill for the board, but the assessor, I think, is entitled to be able to pursue the litigation he deems necessary. This allows him to do that. But here's the thing. I think as a practical matter, number one, I doubt that they're going to use the full 50. I can't guarantee that. But this is for two additional years, and they're trying to settle those two additional years, but they need an appraisal for those two additional years to be able to go to the table and settle. And I think that that's kind of really, from discussing this with Bill and what the rationale was, this would allow them to be in a position to meet the appraisal of the other side and sit down and hash this out. I don't think this is going to be going to litigation again, but you know, I can't guarantee that, but I would really doubt that. It seems to me that they're on the path because they've had a court decision With regard to the prior 2 years, they came kind of between where the State Board of Equalization was and where Bill was, probably closer to where this board had recommended before it withdrew from that litigation and allowed Bill to go forward with it. But still, it was about $10 million more than the State Board of Equalization. And this would allow them to finalize this process and just get this thing put to bed finally.
Mr. Straub, Mr. Chairman, if I might just ask, I guess, two questions. There has been some settlement in regards to Pima County and Raytheon on some other, on more recent years of tax.
You know, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Carroll, I'm not in a position to confirm that. I just don't know. I mean, what they litigated the other.
I do believe there have been some settlements on some years, but not all. Prior to the settlements that have go ahead.
I don't know. I just know that since this board had this item before it, I can't remember which 2 years it was. It was the two prior years. Maybe it was 8 and 9. And I think this is for 10 and 11, I'm not certain, right. But somewhere. But those were litigated, and then there may be other years that they did settle on. That's probably, you know, I'm not going to dispute that. Bill's not here, and he would be able to best address those issues.
We know there's been some movement towards settlement, at least, and some settlements occurring between the assessor's office and Raytheon. I believe that all of us at the board level respect that Mr. Staples is a duly elected line officer, but I think there has been resolutions passed before, or at least comments made by individuals that make up a majority of the board, that we would not have acted in the same way legally or professionally. The important thing now is maybe we should gather that information about what has been settled, what needs to continue to be settled, and what's still out there waiting to be addressed, and delay this until the first week in September so we can get an idea how much. If you say it's not going to be 50,000, how much? I'm with Supervisor Miller in District 1 that, you know, this is sending a mixed message, but please, I'd like to bring some closure, so maybe we should understand from the assessor, maybe you'd like to put it on executive session, how much money exactly is it going to take to get these final appraisals done to move towards what is a settlement, so we can move on happily down the path into the sunlit open field of Raytheon doing business forever here.
Mr. Chairman.
A little sarcastic.
Supervisor Miller.
If Mr. Staples chooses to continue suing Raytheon, why doesn't he find the money within his budget rather than using county tax dollars to sue Raytheon? I do understand that, but he can pull it out of his own budget instead of pulling it out of our general fund.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chairman, Supervisor Miller, the costs incurred by the elected official in terms of vindicating whatever their interest is, and in this case, Mr. Staples, whether it be for outside counsel, because we're paying outside counsel costs for this as well, the expenses necessary, the supporting litigation expenses, are properly a county charge. There's case law to that effect. Yes, they are, and he's a general fund. Yeah, he's a. Yeah.
Well, we have a motion on the floor. Is there any further discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor Carroll.
I know there was a motion on the floor to deny this, was it?
That's correct.
Correct.
Mr. Chairman, I think maybe what we should do is ask to delay this until we can get maybe an executive session, an opportunity to have the county assessor, whether he would like to do that in executive session or publicly explain to us what he may need to conclude and to bring closure to these disagreements with Raytheon over their past tax.
That's in the form of a substitute motion. I'll second it.
Then I will make it in the form of a substitute motion that we delay until the first week in September this item to find out further information.
I'll withdraw my motion.
Thank you, Chairman. Supervisor Miller.
Thank you. So now the motion before us Why don't we, just for the sake of clarity, Ray, why don't you make it as a motion as opposed to substitution?
Yes, sir, I'll try to. On reaction to Supervisor Miller's move to deny, I'd like to move instead a substitute motion to review Brecken Nava Group Amendment Number 2 for September 3rd meeting. In both public and executive sessions.
Is there a second to the motion?
Second.
All right. The motion before us is on continuing item number 13 to the September 3rd Board of Supervisors meeting in both executive and public session. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Item number 12, 17,
Mr. Chairman,
and 18. Supervisor Elias.
I'll move items 12, 17, and 18.
Second. Motion and a second to approve items number 12, 17, and 18. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. Hearings, transportation, item number 19, traffic ordinance number 2013-40.
Mr. Chairman,
I
move to close the public hearing, and also the same motion that we made on item 20, that we notice the meeting for September 26th, notify all the neighborhood and people affected at the school. And I move to close the public hearing and approve the Department of Transportation Traffic Ordinance 2013-41 of the Board of Supervisors regulating parking on Albany Avenue.
Second.
Motion and a second to close the public hearing and approve item 19, ordinance number 2013-40, with the similar hearing requirements and that the September 26th meeting be noticed to the public along with neighbors and the school users. Is that correct?
Yes.
All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, please signify by saying nay. Ayes have it. That means that we are at the end of the meeting. I do not have any speaker cards for call to the public. Is there anyone here who would like to address the board call to the public? Seeing none, this meeting stands adjourned.